Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming by and taking a listen to us. And I can testify to Ron's point about his wife. His wife definitely drove a lot of the speed and accuracy in which we took care of him. So the Whipple procedure. The Whipple is sort of the granddaddy of operations that we do as surgeons. And the primary reason to do a Whipple is to take out tumors of the duodenum or the head of the pancreas. Let's see if this guy's playing here. There we go. Is there a way to turn the volume off? I don't think you want to hear me saying this twice.
Or a pancreatic duodenectomy.
Sorry, they're doing it in the back here. Play it.
The first step of the Whipple resection is
down.
To mobilize the hepatic flexure of the colon and cocorize the duodenum.
Can you turn the volume off, please? Yes, thank you. Thank you. Great. So the head of the pancreas and the duodenum sit behind the colon, and the first thing we do is we mobilize the colon. And you can see that the duodenum surrounds the head of the pancreas, and they're essentially inseparable. So if you take out one, you have to take out the other. So the second task is to mobilize the head of the pancreas and the duodenum. And as you can see, some of the biggest blood vessels in the body sit in this area, so you have to be very careful when you do this. So during this operation, we will first take out the gallbladder. We'll cut across the stomach and the small intestine called the jejunum, and across the neck of the pancreas and the common bile duct. We'll take that out, send it for analysis, make sure we've gotten everything out. The next task is that we have to put everything back together. So we'll bring up a loop of intestine called the jejunum. We'll connect the pancreas to the jejunum called a pancreaticojejunostomy. We connect the common bile duct up to the jejunum called the choledochojejunostomy. And then we connect the stomach to the intestine called a gastrojejunostomy. We'll oftentimes leave a drain, which is a thin plastic tubing that comes in through the side into the area to remove unwanted fluid. And we'll also oftentimes put in a gastrostomy tube or a G-tube. That's a tube that goes through the skin into the stomach, and this allows us to avoid putting in a nasogastric tube, which is a tube that goes through the nose and is quite uncomfortable. In terms of risks for this operation, you know, again, as we said, you know, this is sort of the biggest operation we do as surgeons. So one of the more common ones is what we call delayed gastric emptying. That's when the stomach doesn't push food through the stomach as efficiently as it did prior. This happens to about 10% of patients, and it can last a week, a couple of weeks. In very rare cases, it can last a couple of months. But the stomach always comes back, and the gastrostomy tube helps us keep you comfortable if that happens to you. About 10% of our patients will become diabetic because we're removing insulin-producing cells with the head of the pancreas. And one of the big ones that we are always concerned about is there's always a possibility of having a leak at any of the connections that we make. And the one that we worry about most is the pancreaticojejunostomy, and that's called a pancreatic leak. If you have a pancreatic leak that happens maybe about 10% of the time, typically we can control that with drains that come in through the skin into the area. In terms of your postoperative stay with us, typically most people will hang around for about 5 to 7 days. It can be shorter, and it can certainly be longer. If it's longer than 7 days, don't get concerned. We're just trying to make sure that you're healthy enough to, you know, take care of yourself when you get out of there. We will definitely monitor your blood sugar very closely. And if you're showing evidence of diabetes, then we can prescribe medications that can help control your blood sugar. Pain control is one of our, you know, one of the key things that we worry about and that we're concerned about. So immediately postoperatively, we give you non-narcotic medications in combination with narcotics. Toradol is sort of like super Tylenol. It basically takes the edge off most of the discomfort. The PCA, or patient-controlled analgesia, is a button we give you. So that way you can give yourself doses of medication if you need it, rather than having to wait for, you know, a nurse to bring you the medications. Once you're eating and drinking, we'll give you oral pain medications, which has sort of a longer-lasting, more even pain control. For those who have chronic pain, we have a whole toolbox of things that we can use to help control the chronic pain, including a pain service, which is a group of specialists who, you know, their only job in life is to help control chronic pain and take care of patients. We have a very standard way of making sure that your stomach is working well enough to eat and drink, and so we'll, you know, kind of put you through your paces in that sense. And then we'll also put you on a post-pancreatectomy diet. And this primarily consists of eating smaller meals more frequently rather than eating three big meals a day, four to six smaller meals. We try to restrict the dietary fat to help avoid symptoms of pancreatic insufficiency like bloating and diarrhea. And it's very important to note that in the first month or two as you're recovering from this operation, you may have days when you feel dog tired, when you feel like you just can't eat anything, and that's okay. It happens periodically. And then the other great thing that the Pancreas Center offers, I don't know where Deb is, but Deb is, there she is, right over there. Deb is our new clinical nutritionist, and she's here to help. There you go. So Deb is here to help make sure that our patients are getting the nutrition that they need and doing well from that standpoint. And I'm just going to leave you with one last thought. So lots and lots of studies have shown that where you have your operation done is critically important. And so what they found in study and time after time is that patient outcomes and the risk of complications are better, less if you're at a high-volume center. High-volume centers means that your surgeon and or your institution do at least 16 to 20 of these operations a year, and you can see that our group does many times that number. So we, under Dr. Chabot's leadership, we've really sort of blossomed into one of the highest centers, if not the highest in the country. So with that, I'm going to stop, and I'm going to introduce Bob Brown. So if you've driven down the West Side Highway or watched any TV whatsoever, you've seen his handsome face already. So.